Good evening, and welcome to our continuing series on the life divine with our beloved Ranga. Namaste. We are in chapter 2, the two negations, the materialist denial, and we begin with the paragraph, "It is necessary, therefore."
Okay. So, we'll read the whole para and then we come back to it. It is necessary, therefore, that advancing knowledge should base herself on a clear, pure and disciplined intellect. It is necessary too that she should correct her errors sometimes by a return to the restraint of sensible fact, the concrete realities of the physical world. The touch of earth is always reinvigorating to the son of earth, even when he seeks a supraphysical knowledge. It may even be said that the supraphysical can only be really mastered in its fullness to the heights we can always
reach.
When we keep our feet firmly on the physical. Earth is his footing, says the Upanishad, whenever it images the self that manifests the universe. And it is certainly the fact that the wider we extend and the surer we make our knowledge of the physical world, the wider and surer becomes our foundation for the higher knowledge. Even for the highest, even for the Brahma Vidya. There are a lot of things here which he expands in other paras and other places. So we'll look at those things and go into a little detail because he is talking of the word, for instance, extending, widening, heightening. So all these things we'll look at a little carefully. It is necessary, therefore, that advancing knowledge, note the word knowledge with a K cap. He is not talking of scientific knowledge. He is talking of essential knowledge of the fundamental principles of existence. Or if you want to put it in less philosophical language, knowledge of God. Okay, so it's a special knowledge that he is talking about, not material knowledge. It is necessary, therefore, that advancing knowledge should base herself on a clear, pure and disciplined intellect. You must be very rational in your approach to even supraphysical things. It is necessary too that she should correct her errors sometimes by a return to the restraint of sensible fact, the concrete realities of the physical world. Always keep your feet firmly on the ground. Don't have any hazy, fuzzy-wuzzy ideas, that's what he is saying. The touch of earth is always reinvigorating to the son of earth. And there is another thing also implied there. All physical truths have a reflection in the physical world. You can always find some parallels. That's why they say that the physical world is a symbol of the divine. Whatever the spiritual truths are there, some symbolic thing is always there in the physical world representing that. In fact, everything that exists in the physical world has its archetype in heaven. So, if you refer here, you can also, from if you go there, you can see its reflection here in the physical world. So, you must always be able to connect the two. That's what he's saying. Okay, then, the touch of earth is always reinvigorating to the son of earth, even when he seeks a supraphysical knowledge. Again, knowledge with a K-cap. It may even be said that the supraphysical can only be really mastered in its fullness. Now we have that famous dash again. So, the dash we will first eliminate and then we'll come back to it. It may even be said that the supraphysical can only be really mastered in its fullness when we keep our feet firmly on the physical. So, he's saying it is, he's putting in parenthetical, to the heights we can always reach. because it's relatively easier to rise than to pull down that into the physical world. That's very difficult. Descending is very difficult. In Sri Ramdas Yoga, there is an ascent and a descent. In all our Indian traditionals, they don't care for the descent. Let the body mind life be as it is, it will never be corrected. Let's go up in our consciousness to the heights and be blissful there. That's the whole idea. But in Sri Ramdas idea, you must always be able to bring down all that into the physical world. So you must, if you go only there, your knowledge is not complete and full. So he's saying that your knowledge will be complete and full only when you have your feet firmly planted on the ground and have the knowledge, divine knowledge, even when you are in a waking consciousness in the world. Most yogis, they are very happy with the trance knowledge. Their consciousness rises up, they lose the consciousness of the physical world and they are very happy there. But the moment they come back here, they have to come back, they have to eat, they have to sleep. The moment they do that, they are back into their old imperfect nature. But Sri Ramdas says, no, you must be able to make that ascent and descent. That's very important. It is a very important concept in Sri Ramdas. Ascent, first you have to ascend. Know what it is, get the knowledge, then bring it down into the physical world. Waking samadhi, if you want, not a trance samadhi. Don't lose your consciousness. Of course, he says later on that the highest heights you can go only in trance. You can't go with the waking consciousness. It's not subtle enough to rise to that highest. So you have to leave your waking consciousness here and then go up only to the highest heights. But that's exactly what he wants, to join the two. Marrying the soil to the sky. That's his phrase, which he uses all the time.
Yes.
Okay? So, when we keep our feet firmly on the physical, earth is its footing, says the Upanishad, whenever it images the self that manifests in the universe. Note interestingly how even man and his body structure is a symbol of the layers of existence, the planes of existence. The feet are always the lowest. They represent the matter and even the inconscient, if you want. Even the chakras, they represent all that. So at the highest level, you get illumination. Above the head, you are in the higher spiritual planes of consciousness. In the mind, you are in the mental knowledge. When you are here, you are in the vital plane of consciousness. When you are below your navel, you are in the semi-subconscient, and finally in the coccyx bone, which you go down, that's it, absolute inconscience. So even the body is a symbol of the arrangement of the planes of consciousness. So you have to be able to bring down that consciousness right into your body. There's a very interesting poem by Sri Ramdas, The Golden Light.
Yes.
In his case, he says the golden light came down here, went right down into his feet. That's the descent that he's talking about. Even when you are in a waking consciousness, the divine consciousness is always there in you. It's not so with the normal yogi. He loses that, it remains there, but you have to pull it down. And pulling it down and making it a reality here is what Sri Ramdas wants.
When he speaks of the lotus, he says, don't try to analyze it by the mud in which it grows, but seek its heavenly archetype.
Archetype, exactly. Okay? So then, and it is certainly the fact that the wider we extend and the surer we make our knowledge of the physical world, the wider and surer becomes our foundation for the higher knowledge, even for the highest, even for the Brahma Vidya. Now this last sentence is interesting because he is talking of wider and surer. When the scientist is exploring the secrets of nature, what's he doing? He is only widening his knowledge. He knows more and more about matter. It's a horizontal knowledge. But yogi gets vertical knowledge. He goes up, ignores the base and goes up. And he knows only that. He doesn't know anything about this. Ask him about physical, the properties of matter, he will not be able to tell you. But Sri Ramdas is saying, ascent and descent, you have to widen your base, you have to heighten your base. then you get the whole picture. He has got a whole chapter in Life Divine later on, the ascent and integration. When you ascend, you have to integrate the lower into the higher. So his view of consciousness is, deepen your consciousness, widen your consciousness, heighten your consciousness. In that case, you have the whole universe within you, in your grasp. So that's a very important concept. He has a whole chapter on that. He is not eliminating physical knowledge. In fact, in the synthesis, is very clear. If you are a scientist and you have a touch of spiritual life, you don't need to give up your scientist. If you are a doctor, you can continue your being a doctor and practice your spiritual life. Normally, the idea in India is give up the world and go in to the forest and concentrate all the time. No, Swamiji is saying it can be done. So, scientific knowledge of matter is part of spirituality. It can become part of spirituality, and it should be according to Sri Aurobindo. That's the paragraph. Even for the Brahma Vidya, you don't need to give up the physical world. Keep your feet firmly on the ground. In emerging, therefore, out of the materialistic period of human knowledge, we must be careful that we do not rashly condemn what we are leaving or throw away even a tittle of its gains before we can summon perceptions and powers that are well grasped and secure to occupy their place. Rather, we shall observe with respect and wonder the work that atheism has done for the divine and admire the services that agnosticism has rendered in preparing the illimitable increase of knowledge. In our world, error is continually the handmaid and pathfinder of truth. For error is really a half-truth that stumbles because of its limitations. Often, it is truth that wears a disguise in order to arrive unobserved near to its goal. Well, if it could always be as it has been in the great period we are leaving, the faithful handmaid, severe, conscientious, clean-handed, luminous, within its limits, a half-truth and not a reckless and presumptuous aberration. We should not be afraid of errors. Even errors are pointers to the truth. That's what he says in many places. There are children who ask me after the third year, I don't know what to do. I have a tendency for going into psychology, or I feel like doing garment designing. What should I do? They wonder. So my always answer to them is, try out one, find out the truth, and then. No, but I would have wasted 1 or 2 years. There is no waste in life. Everything is a learning process, and even the errors that you have made are going to help you. So don't think. You can't know the truth. You have to experiment, find out by errors, and go ahead. So we should never be afraid of experimenting and trying out all things. Of course, the collective knowledge is there, and that can always help. Like in science, collective knowledge is there and you have to use that base. You don't need to reinvent the wheel, as they say.
And he has this extraordinary line in Savitri, our errors are his steps upon the way.
And here he's saying the same thing. He's saying error is really a half-truth that stumbles in its limitations. And also he's saying handmaid. Error, faithful handmaid, severe, conscientious, clean-handed, luminous within its limits, half-truth and not a reckless and presumptuous aberration. Even errors can be made use of.
Well, you might say something about atheism and agnosticism, because that's an important line.
Atheism and agnosticism, he's talking about that. So, there are many people who believe anything that is told to them. But if you are very, very rational and you are thinking and you accept things without thinking deeply of them, you can be in a great amount of confusion and things. So, everything that is presented to you, you must be able to except after considering. In fact, I tell the students always, Sri Ramdev is always truthful, yeah, but examine his and convince yourself that it is true. Then only proceed. Don't accept in toto just because Sri Ramdev is saying. Find out the truth of what he is saying, find out the, put the opposite thesis to yourself, examine its invalidness and then come back to Sri Ramdev. So that's what you must always be. So atheism, you can take in two ways. One is a negative atheism which says, nah, without examination I say no, it doesn't, I don't accept. But the other atheism is a doubt. So doubt can have a positive aspect and a negative aspect. So positive aspect is good. Positive doubt. Questioning and positive doubt is always good to question and then accept, not to accept without examination. Agnosticism is the same thing. Agnosticism, there are two. I said one is maybe it is true, but I don't know about it. That is one way. But I keep an open mind, and if I am convinced, I will accept it. So that's a positive agnosticism. So both atheism and agnosticism can be also positive things, provided you are not negative in your approach. Without examining to say that I don't accept is a negative atheism, but there can be a positive atheism also. Open-mindedness. Yes, I don't see it, so my tendency is not to accept it very easily, but I am open. If tomorrow something comes to me and I can be convinced about it, very good, I'll accept. So, negative atheism and a positive atheism. So, doubt can be, doubt, the word doubt can be misleading, but you can have a suspended judgment, I would put it. Suspended judgment is good. Okay? A certain kind of agnosticism is the final truth of all knowledge. For when we come to the end of whatever path, the universe appears as only a symbol or an appearance of an unknowable reality which translates itself here into different systems of values, physical values, vital and sensational values, intellectual, ideal and spiritual values. The more that becomes real to us, the more it is seen to be always beyond defining thought and beyond formulating expression. Mind attains not there, nor speech. And yet, it is possible to exaggerate with the illusionists the unreality of the appearance. So it is possible to exaggerate the unknowableness of the unknowable. When we speak of it as unknowable, we mean really that it escapes the grasp of our thought and speech. Instruments which proceed always by the sense of difference and express by the way of definition. But if not knowable by thought, it is attainable by a supreme effort of consciousness. There is even a kind of knowledge which is one with identity and by which, in a sense, it can be known. Certainly, that knowledge cannot be reproduced successfully in the terms of thought and speech. But when we have attained to it, the result is a re-evaluation of that in the symbols of our cosmic consciousness. Not only in one, but in all the ranges of symbols, which results in a revolution of our internal being and through the internal of our external life. Moreover, there is also a kind of knowledge through which that does reveal itself by all these names and forms of phenomenal existence, which to the ordinary intelligence only conceal it. It is this higher but not highest process of knowledge to which we can attain by passing the limits of the materialistic formula and scrutinizing life, mind and supermind in the phenomena that are characteristic of them, and not merely in those subordinate movements by which they link themselves to matter. Huge sentence running into so many lines. Sometimes I tell the students,
Which is the verb and which is the subject? Tell me. And what are the parenthetical phrases in between? Otherwise you get confused. By the time you come to the end, you've forgotten what you said in the beginning. It happens all the time.
When Prithvi Singh Nahar was typing out the Life Divine, he would constantly send Sri Aurobindo a note. It needs a full stop here. It needs another full stop. And Sri Aurobindo wrote, enough stops now?
That's his style. Someone suggested that your style is global, and Sri Aurobindo liked that word very much. He said, yes, that's a wonderful word, global. His language is global. He encompasses everything in one sentence. We would have used 5 sentences to describe what he is saying in one sentence. So, a very big para, and I think we have read it once before.
Yeah,
we have read it. But if you want, we can look at it again.
Sure.
In fact, you can always read Sri Aurobindo and benefit again and again when you read. You understand more of what he is saying every time. But that happens to all, in everything. You see a movie a second time, you will see things which you have missed the first time. So if you in a movie you miss, how much more you will miss here? Okay? So, a certain kind of agnosticism is the final truth of all knowledge. So, because when you reach a certain level, what you see below yourself seems to become clearer and you see to understand. But what is above you still is a mystery. That is why he is saying a certain kind of agnosticism, because your consciousness has reached a point where it understands the things below you. But above you, you have still not yet developed that capacity to go to that, so you don't understand that and it's a mystery. So this is the problem. This is what he is saying, a certain kind of agnosticism is the final truth of all knowledge. Then he is telling you later on, by that we mean mental knowledge. But consciousness can identify itself. He is talking of 2 different things. Identification he is talking of, and intuition. He is talking of 2 things there. No? We'll look at it. So, a certain kind of agnosticism is the final truth of all knowledge. To whatever level you go, some things become clearer, but there is always something unknown. In fact, the Divine has, broadly speaking, 3 levels: the transcendent, the cosmic, and the individual. So when the saint or the devotee experiences the Divine in himself, it is so satisfying, he thinks that that's all, the Divine is in everybody. He ignores the cosmic aspect and he ignores the transcendent aspect. The ascetic, when he goes to the transcendent aspects, feels that this is the ultimate, this is the highest knowledge. The one who worships nature, pantheism, the pantheist, thinks that God is in the universe and nothing else. So these 3 experiences are exclusive of each other. They don't always coincide. You can have one without the knowledge of the others. So agnosticism is always there. Something is always known, unknown. When you combine all these things, it becomes integral. Okay? So, for when we come to the end of whatever path, the universe appears only as a symbol or an appearance of an unknowable reality which translates itself here into different systems of values: physical values, vital and sensational values, intellectual, ideal and spiritual values. I think we discussed this also one day. Yeah. First of all, for the animal, the physical world is real. For man, also most men, the physical world is very, very real, and we see things in a physical manner. Sri Aurobindo himself gives the example of the sun rising. I see the sun rising clearly. Where is the doubt? There is no doubt that the sun is rising. It's moving upwards. You are at a sense level. The senses are giving you knowledge. So you are at a vital, sensual level. The moment you start thinking at a mental level, you go up, your values change. You realize that the sun is not moving at all, but you are moving. So your values have changed. Your way of looking at things has changed. Same thing happens at the spiritual level, and even at the highest level, everything is relative. That's what he's saying. And everything below seems to be a representation. He's using the word symbolism. Everything is a symbol of the... everything below you is a symbol of what you are realizing. Everything is a symbol in the physical world. Its archetype is in heaven. But here, there is a very interesting thing which Ramakrishna found out, because when his kundalini was rising, you hear sounds. That is also there in Savitri, the description of the kundalini sounds. It's very interesting. Very few people know about it, but actually these sounds are all described in Savitri without saying that they are kundalini sounds. The world stare, that chapter is there in which he describes all the kundalini sounds. The wind flowing through trees, the roar of the sea, the humming of bees, the tinkling of a bell, the caravan going, these are all kundalini sounds. Yes. And he doesn't mention that they are kundalini sounds. But I came to know about it because I had a meeting with a yogi who explained to me these kundalini sounds. And when I found them in Savitri, it is so clear, he has mentioned all of them. The temple gong, dum, yes. dum, yes. dum, or the roar of the sea, or a waterfall, whoosh. These are the kundalini sounds. As each center opens up, you get these sounds. So when Ramakrishna heard these sounds, he said, now I understand the origin of all animal sounds. Mm. The roaring of animals, the barking of dogs, the mewing of cats, all these sounds, from where they are coming, he could understand. So that's what he's saying. Everything in the physical world is a symbol of higher realities. Okay, so, it's only a symbol and appearance. So, this is clear now. Physical values, vital values, sensational values, intellectual values, ideal values and spiritual values. This is also interesting. The ideal values tell the truth, moral values. When you silence your mind and go up into the nirvana experience, all the opposites, they appear to be of the same vibrational quality. Sin and virtue are only two poles of the same vibration. They are not different. At our level, yes, you have to avoid sin. But when you go up, you see that they are only two different qualities of the same vibration. Mother also says this very clearly. There is no difference. You have transcended your moral values. Ethics is an invention of the mind. So when you go into a spiritual consciousness, morality doesn't apply anymore. For the spiritual man, morality is not an issue at all, because he has to see the soul. Morality belongs to the body-mind life, not to the soul. The soul is something that even through evil, you can get positive things. Even through that which you see as negative, you can see positive things. we have got very clear ideas about war is bad, storms are bad, because they have an effect on us which is bad. But behind, if you see the reality, everything has got a purpose and there's a value to it. So, when you rise to the spiritual level, moral values are no more, even ideal values, no more valid. To be a nationalist and love your country is fine. When you become a spiritual person, you see that it's a narrowness. In fact, Sri Aurobindo says, nationalism is nothing but the herd instinct. In fact, this is now recognized all over the world also, that nationalism is something with lot of negative vibrations to it. You must become more international. You must not be limited only to your national views. That's something which is accepted nowadays. But that's what he's talking about here. As you rise in consciousness, values go on changing. Higher and higher values. But that doesn't mean to say that when you are at a lower level of consciousness, you must try and apply the higher values. You will go wrong. The lower values are valid for you. When you are in your ordinary consciousness, by all means, avoid sin and go only to virtue. But if you are at a higher level of consciousness, the yogi can see that sin and virtue are basically the same. Note interestingly that those who are virtuous are so full of themselves. They are rigid and they cannot be changed. Oh, I cannot do these things. I am absolutely pure. You are so rigid that you cannot change. In fact, Mother says those who are very, very virtuous and Puritan, in English you use the word Puritan, we are rigid in your fixities, you are incapable of doing the other thing. So that's a limitation. And Mother says those who are virtuous are very often very more difficult to change than those who are open and sinful. In fact, what happened once, there was an interesting thing happened. Somebody came from outside to the ashram and claimed that he was an Indian pilot in the Air Force. And Mother was giving him a good deal of attention. She was giving him a good deal of attention. He remained here for 3 months and then he went away. After some time, a pilot from Delhi, I forget his name, Sony, his name was Sony. He used to come regularly to the ashram and they said, oh, one of your co-workers were here. And he said, who was here? Then they gave the name and he said, there is no such person in the Air Force. So it turned out that he was a fraud. So some people went to Mother and said, Mother, you were giving this chap so much attention. He is actually an imposter. He is not at all in the... Mother smiled and said that, do you think that I look at the outer nature of man? I look at the soul and see what the soul wants. We act according to the soul's needs, not what the body-mind life is. That's only the clothes. Do you judge a man by his clothes? No. You judge him by what he is really. So this is what Mother told her. This is exactly what Srinivas is pointing out. Your values go on changing as you go higher and higher in life. In fact, the Gita says very clearly, even a worst sinner has to be considered a saint if he turns to me. So sin and virtue are all mental values. They have no spiritual values. There is nothing spiritual about them. If you are a note, interestingly also, that in the Bhagavad Gita, Shri Krishna is actually encouraging Arjuna to kill his own family members. Think about that. It would be a crime of the first order. But here it is not so. In fact, this is what is not understood at all by many who read the Bhagavad Gita, particularly in the West, they don't understand this at all. That the Bhagavad Gita, they say, is a manual for war and violence. It's not that at all. When you are at a higher level of consciousness, the actions don't matter at all. It's the attitude with which you are doing the action that matters. You can even kill with compassion, like Durga. Even when she is killing the asuras, it is out of compassion and love that she is doing that. Not out of hatred and out of violence and hatred and rejection. No. So it depends on the attitude. Even in life here, what we do, the attitude is more important than the actual act. Last time we mentioned, I think, I can tell the truth with an evil intention. If I tell the truth, sometimes the person can get into deep trouble. Because I know that he has done something wrong. The real thing would be to keep quiet and not reveal it. But if I reveal with a bad intention that yes, is like that, you will be doing harm to that person. You can tell lies also, but normally it's always better to avoid lies. But even that can become a semi-truth. So you have to be very, very careful about this. Particularly, use of truth can also be bad. That you have to realize fully. So values go on changing as you go in higher and higher in consciousness.
After I met Mother, my life was turned upside down. And so I wrote to her, what should I do in life? Should I continue studying my vocal music or learn to be a conductor of choirs? Mother writes, one or the other, because the most important thing is not so much what you choose, but the spirit in which you will do it.
Exactly. The inner attitude is what matters. The outer act. We always judge everybody by their outer acts. But you have to see the intention behind it. That is the real thing. Okay? So we were at that place where we were talking of values. Different systems of values: physical values, vital values, sensational values, intellectual and ideal and spiritual values. The ideals that you have also change when you go to a spiritual level. The more that becomes real to us, the more it is seen to be always beyond defining thought and beyond formulating expression. When you are, logic is always very, very clear, it makes differences. It judges by difference. If there is no difference, there is confusion in the mind. So at our level, we have to be logical and we have to define. That's a huge asset that we have as human beings. But as you go higher up, division gives way to unity. So then the values change altogether. So mind cannot go beyond its own capacity. It has to abdicate. Okay? The more that becomes real to us, the more it is seen to be always beyond defining thought and formulating expression. Then we have the quotation from the Kena Upanishad. Mind attains not there, nor speech. When you go there, you cannot express. And that is the reason why it becomes, what you call, ineffable. It becomes, you cannot put into words and you cannot express in language. It becomes impossible. And yet, as it is possible to exaggerate with the illusionists the unreality of the appearance, so it is possible to exaggerate the unknowableness of the unknowable. When we speak of it as unknowable, we mean really that it escapes the grasp of our thought and speech. Instruments which proceed always by the sense of difference and express by the way of definition. You define something, then it is clear. When somebody asks a question sometimes which is not very clear, you say, please reformulate your question clearly. That means you want it to be put into clear words so that you express yourself clearly without any confusion in the mind. So the capacity of the mind is to define with difference. You must be very, very careful there. But if not knowable by thought, it is attainable by supreme effort of consciousness. Mental consciousness is not the only consciousness we discussed last time. Consciousness is like light or sound. Human beings are only open to a small range of this. Okay? But sounds are there which are below our capacity to hear. Dogs can hear, other animals can hear. High-pitched sounds also we can't hear. Exactly in the same way, light also, ultraviolet, infrared, we can't see. We are only open to the Vibhjyotir range. Consciousness is exactly of that same nature. There is an infinite consciousness above and an infinite consciousness below, which becomes unconscious, but we are only open to a certain small range. So, mind is of that small range, but there are consciousness above. Consciousness itself, when it goes to that level, it can understand things which we can't understand by the mind. That's what he said.
In two sentences, Sri Aurobindo capitalizes it four times.
Yes. And what is that it? Let's go back and see. Okay? So, I often ask the students, what is this it? What is this she that he's talking about? They have to find out. That is why it becomes clear. Okay? Then. The more that becomes real to us. Okay? So, and if you go even more back, the unknowable reality. So, that it that he is talking about, if you go carefully backwards, it is that it that he is talking with a capital I, that and the unknowable reality.
When we speak of it, yeah, as unknowable.
Yeah. That unknowable reality. That's why the it. It escapes the grasp of our thought. That ultimate reality you cannot know. That's what he says. It is attainable by supreme effort of consciousness. Yeah. Again and again, that it. He could have said that, but it almost comes to the same thing. It or that. So if you go back, you will see that he is talking of the unknowable reality with an R cap. for our understanding, replace it with a very, very wide term, God, if you want. Then it will be clear to us. All right? There is even a kind of knowledge which is one with identity, by which, in a sense, it can be known. It can be known. Identity, you become the divine. This is something that is not acceptable in the Christian theology. You cannot become the divine. You can have experience of him. You can sense him. You can have a relation with him. But to become the divine is blasphemy. It's the same with Islam also. There is no question at all. There is a book, Amal Kiran's correspondence with a Jesuit, and he settled in India. He was very much attracted to the Indian philosophy. So he settled here. And they had a huge correspondence. There is a whole book for it. He just wouldn't accept that you can become the divine. But in our Indian tradition, you are already the divine, covered up with many false layers. Your body is a thick layer, your vital is a layer, your mind is a layer, and hiding behind that is the divine in an individual form. So you are the divine essentially. Everything in the world is divine, but in a different form, in a different grade. Okay? So it can be known. Certainly, that knowledge cannot be reproduced successfully in the terms of thought and speech, but when we have attained to it, the result is a revaluation of that in the symbols of our cosmic consciousness, not only in one, but in all the ranges of symbols, which results in a revolution of our internal being and through the internal of our external life. If all values completely change when you know that, your life will become totally different. Moreover, there is also a kind of knowledge through which that does reveal itself by all these names and forms of phenomenal existence, which to the ordinary intelligence only conceal it. One example will make this very clear. We would see a criminal or a murderer and we will say these are all criminals and bad people. Sriranda in jail, when he is in the court, he is seeing criminals and murderers, he is seeing Sri Krishna in them. So, everything changes when you go to that level of consciousness. And you start seeing them only as the coverings are there, but behind the covering there is a reality. Your internal seeing as well as external seeing becomes completely changed when you realize that. This is the kind of knowledge that he's talking about, through which that does reveal itself by all these names and forms. The names and forms in Indian philosophy you call it nama rupa. These are the outer forms. The physical forms are the names and forms. I take a good deal of time to explain nama, why they call nama to the students, because you have a name, okay? You are Anmol, you are Madhukar. If I change your name, will it change you? So the name is only a convention. Your body-mind life is only a convention of your soul. The soul is a reality. Your body-mind life, tomorrow, next life will change your body-mind life. No importance at all. That's why it's only a name and a form. And a form can be destroyed and rebuilt. A new form can come. There is the nama-rupa and there is the essential reality. That's why everything in the physical world is nama and rupa. Okay? So if they use the word names and forms of phenomenal existence, which to our ordinary intelligence only conceal it. So your body-mind life is concealing the reality behind. Okay? It is this higher but not highest process of knowledge to which we can attain by passing the limits of the materialistic formula and scrutinizing life, mind and supermind in the phenomena that are characteristic of them and not merely in those subordinate movements by which they link themselves to matter. There are three levels, very broadly speaking, three levels. Dikshara. Dikshara is the mutable world which we normally see. Then when you have made your mind silent, you go to the akshara consciousness, which is the immutable. That's the next chapter. We'll have to give full attention to that. That's the next chapter. Where you are in a consciousness which is essentially spiritual and you can get knowledge there. But it's not the highest. To get the highest, you have to go even higher up beyond the cosmic. You have to go to the transcendental. So that is the third level. So he's talking of that. He's saying, not the highest. Where is it? It is the this higher, but not highest process of knowledge. So you can go to the spiritual knowledge, which is not the highest. That's what the ascetic does. He goes to the second level and he thinks he has got knowledge, but it's not the highest knowledge. Because he is rejecting the physical world. If you are in that, you see the physical world as unreal and you are satisfied with that. The ascetic is satisfied with that. But the highest knowledge will tell you that even things in the physical world have a reality behind them. They are representations of the heavenly archetypes. That's the third level of knowledge. Okay?